Very good afternoon. Yes, please, Anne, if we could go to slide six, that would be great. Just showing the group with the two separate divisions. Investment management, Tatton Investment Management on the left-hand side. Basically, that is the growth division of the whole organization. I would say the majority of reason why shareholders have purchased our shares in the past. We are a discretionary fund manager dealing exclusively on platforms, UK advisor-led platforms, and exclusively through the IFA community. We were a bit of a price disruptor many moons ago when we launched at 15 basis points, and we remain 15 basis points, which again is still competitively priced in today's world. Grown to 15 billion of management, but I'll come back into further specifics about the investment management division later. Looking to the right-hand side, then we've got IFA Support Services Division or membership. And that's got Paradigm Consulting, which is an IFA support services business, which has over 400 firms that it helps and works with from a business consultancy point of view, keeping those firms on the right side of the regulator, but is not responsible for the errors and omissions of its membership. And Paradigm Mortgage Services is a mortgage aggregation business, which is purely for mortgage advisors, where we can get them the very best the very best type of product, whether it's banking or lending, or whether it's protection in the insurance environment. So with our size and scale, we get the very best terms that the mortgage advisor can utilize, which is going to be a better term that you can get outside of the club. And we retain an element of a clip from all the transactions that are done throughout that membership business. So that's slide six. If we move forward to key highlights, absolutely delighted with this exceptional set of numbers, especially when you look at the sort of the macro position that we're working within. So very, very proud to say over the last 6 months, you know, we've had organic net flows of 910 million. So we're bringing in around about 150 million of new flows every single month. And consistently, we've done that now for 22, 23 months. And post the end of the interim period, in October, we've done another 150, and November, we've done another 150 so far. So effectively, those flows are exceptional. When we look at everything else going on in the world, it's lovely to see those flows coming through. And we've now gone through the 15 billion mark. So that was 14.8 at the interim date, but now through and because of the extra funds that we've received over that period. So a real strong performance, a strong performance across the group from Paradigm Consulting to, and the mortgage numbers increasing. So the mortgage members have increased by over 5.4%. But I think one of the very interesting stats, apart from the obvious ones that you can read and that are shaded in green, is the fact that we have 114,650 actual individual accounts now. And a little bit of maths, it basically takes you that our average client account size is £130,000. So we've really brought discretionary fund management to the mass market, which we believe is well served by the IFA community and why we remain IFA only. We've got over 914 firms that are supporting us and giving us business on a weekly basis. And again, if you look at that £130,000 and work on our 15 bips explicit fee, that means that effectively clients are getting the full discretionary service for just under £200 per annum, which we think is exceptional. Again, it sort of fits beautifully into the consumer duty legislation that we are all working under with the new legislation from the regulator. And we'll have a slide that addresses consumer duty and why we believe we're very well placed with consumer duty. And we might even receive a little tailwind moving forward for more assets to come our way. So that's it on slide eight. On slide nine, we're basically showing our strong financial performance over a sustained period. So you can see the CAGR there of 24% on profitability and improving the margins as we go through. So as we get more and more assets under management, the margin operational gearing improves. And my erstwhile colleague, Paul Edwards, will take you through that within his deck coming up shortly. And then the next slide, slide 10, is our bragging slide effectively, which shows how the funds under management have come towards us from March 2013 when we launched, getting our first billion in 2013, our second in 2014, our third in 2015, and we've kind of built on from there, and now over the 15 billion that I mentioned earlier. So without further ado, I'll pass you over to Paul, who will take you through the financial performance.
Okay, yeah, thank you, Paul. I'll just probably reiterate really great set of results in this interim period, 6 months to the end of September. I would say also, to some extent, it's also relatively vanilla from our standpoint in that the growth is all organic, you know, and as you saw in one of the previous slides, you know, we remained on our growth track since IPO. So really good growth in revenue, just under 10%. As normal, the main driver is Tatton, helped by a really resilient performance from Paradigm as well. Which I think is, you know, given the less than optimal conditions that we've had over the past 6 months, is a really good position to be in. We've delivered operating profit growth of 11%, but more importantly, that operating gearing that Paul referred to has come through even from a group perspective as well, with margins increasing to just under 51%. We've had our normal adjusting items, you know, the share-based payments and amortization of intangibles. And a key point for us, which doesn't particularly stand out on the slide, but is our debt facility expired in this period, and the interest that you see there, which is a minus 40, will turn into a positive interest of somewhere between 300,000 to 400,000 in H2. And then along with obviously the corporation tax increase to 25%, the earnings per share has increased broadly in line. And then finally, you know, we want to talk about the dividend, where you see a significant increase in the dividend there year on year, 77.8%. Just for clarity, the dividend policy remains the same. So we're paying 70% of earnings. All we've done here is really just change the profile from one third, two thirds to 50-50, which has actually been really well received by our investor base. Moving on to the next slide, Tatton, really strong growth in AUM in the period, just under 15 billion to sit at now. And as Paul mentioned, actually, as we sit here today, actually slightly over 15 billion. Just driven really by organic net inflows this year, 910 million, which has really been consistent over that period. So you'll see there on the slide, you know, Q1 to Q2, very consistent, but broadly pretty consistent month on month as well. Our investment performance has been good, you know, in relative terms to the market and to our peers on ARC. That said, you know, we've only benefited 100 million in this period. And actually, when you go over the last 18 months, actually markets have taken away 300 million from us over that period. So we really had no help from markets over, recent history. Overall translates to 14.5 million of revenue, 13.4% growth, which is really strong. And Tatton actually now contributes 83% of revenue for the group. So really is the vast majority of the group now. So the growth in operating profits obviously is come through as well. Really, really strong gearing in Tatton, with margins increasing to 62%. And, you know, we generally get a question is where will they get to? And the reality is that the nature of our business model is such that, you know, we sit between the platform where, the technology is and where the investment is in terms of, you know, future technology and where all the assets are held. And then obviously the IFA, who deals with the 113,000 clients, where we're actually dealing with 914 firms. So that operating model is such that we have a relatively low cost base. And as long as we continue to deliver 44 portfolios that we currently have, there's no reason why the operating gearing should not continue to come through and margins increase. And then moving to Paradigm, given the context around the housing market recently, you know, we're really pleased with a really resilient performance, as we said earlier. We've seen a modest 5.5% decrease in completions, albeit from a slightly different mix than normal. So as an example of that, you know, product transfers, you know, where typically there'd be about 33% of the overall completions, they've increased to 50%. And a sort of home buyer or a mover mortgage, you know, like a new mortgage, has decreased from 38% from about 47%. And that mix is essentially a lower margin mix for us. That said, you know, the impact on revenue has been relatively modest. It's been obviously helped by the increasing number of firms, but also an increase in protection income too. So as you'll see from, you know, the operating profit and margins, look, we continue to invest in the business. We've taken that choice. And while it has a short-term impact on profit, we think that's the right thing to do. I think, but more importantly, I think as we look forward, you know, there are signs for optimism. I think it's the first increase we've seen in house prices in October since March. Lender competition is increasing and driving down pricing, and the number of available products is actually now at a record over 5,600, which is a record, you know, since the last 14 years, I think, if I understand correctly. And then obviously the recent fall in inflation has helped, you know, and that will certainly help in the medium term, with helping obviously with affordability and ultimately hopefully lower interest rates as we move forward. And looking at the balance sheet on the next slide, look, we have a really strong but simple balance sheet with very, very little movement year on year. Key highlight really is that the group has a very low capital requirement, you know, hence the 24 million of cash on the balance sheet that you see there after paying the final dividend of last year, and cash being still the largest item on the balance sheet. That said, we know the group maintains 40 million net assets. You'll see on the right-hand side on the table, our capital resource, which we hold, is 211% of the requirement, you know, so really strong headroom. And that's obviously after paying the interim dividend or the increased interim dividend that we proposed earlier. And then on the cash flow, again, simple balance sheet, also relatively simple cash flow. Strong cash conversion, you know, the business throws off lots of cash. So 8.3 million generated from operations. All the other uses of cash are pretty vanilla. You know, obviously the year-end dividend and corporation tax payments. Probably the only one that does stand out is a purchase of our own shares. You know, we made a capital allocation decision to do that this year. Mainly because a number of our shareholders have been selling shares. You know, they've had liquidity requirements themselves through redemptions, and we've swept up some of our own shares, which is really just a hedge for the future options that we have. So we spent 2.6 million at the half year and actually just increased that slightly to about 3.2 million in October as well. And then just looking at the outlook, you know, into H2, you know, we've made a pretty strong statement there. We're on track to deliver expectations in that first bullet there. We've got 4.5 months to go. You know, we know Tatton, as Paul said, and I mentioned earlier, flows have been very consistent, and that's been maintained into the first 6 weeks of the second half. So I think that's a really very positive statement. You know, we continue to invest in the business to support that growth. So that'll be, you know, necessary in H2 as well. But then, you know, with my accountant's hat on, I guess, you know, on a cautious note, you know, the world's an uncertain place at the moment. This impacts markets, and therefore, you know, that volatility persists. And while inflation has fallen, it's still relatively high, and therefore some impacts in confidence. So overall, when we look at, you know, Paradigm, you know, the implication for us is that we broadly believe that the Paradigm will deliver pretty much a H2 broadly in line with H1.
Thank you, Paul. Moving to slide 19 now, we just want to look at the strategic side of life. This slide really is very good in describing how the market has grown in DFM MPS. So if we go back to 2017, you can see in the green box there that the actual size of assets from advisor-led platforms was 25 billion in the DFM MPS space. And now we sit in 2023 with the number being 103.5 billion. So been an incredible increase from 25 to 100. And actually the market consultants are basically saying that they think that 100 will actually go to 200 by 2027. And that's a number that we concur with. We can very much see that happening with the momentum that's coming. So MPS is maturing very, very well indeed. As you can see, our market share in 2023 was 13.4%. And if we can maintain that and even grow that a little bit, we would be delighted over the next 4 years as that market increases. So, you know, we have got a lovely market dynamic going on here. And I think, again, when we look at Consumer Duty, you'll see that it might even help and accelerate those flows further than what is predicted. But I know as a management team, we look constantly at what we're doing and what is available in the financial services arena. And there's no finer place to be right now than MPS. There are numerous MPS providers. I think at last count, there were 80 DFM MPSs. So you can imagine that there's a very long tail of smaller ones out there, but there is a myriad of choice. You know, we have got to remain right at the forefront, and we evolve our proposition. But we believe that 15 basis points is the right price. And at the moment, when you look at the average pricing is still 22 basis points, so we're well below the average. There are one or two players who've come in that are cheaper than we are, but aren't necessarily winning the assets that, you may expect them to get. The 14.8 billion number there, showing 14.3, is basically working on the old 103.5 billion. So that might be inflating our market share a little bit, because we think that 103.5 has already grown. So I'd rather work on the 13.4, 13.5% market share for your purposes of calculation. And then on slide 20, we're basically showing that roadmap to growth. We did predict that we'd move from 9 billion to 15 over a 3-year period. And that obviously expires in March 2024. So we're 6 months ahead of plan. We're now through that 15 billion. The makeup's been slightly different, to be honest. We thought the makeup would be 3 billion of new organic flows and 3 billion of effectively M&A or inorganic flows. It's not turned out to be the case. It's been 4.1 has been organic and 1.9 has been M&A activity. And actually, M&A activity, because of the importance of MPS in today's world, is becoming quite difficult. Most MPS providers are either building up their asset base for a sale or partnership later on. But those ones that we have been discussing with have got huge expectations on the value of their business. And I'm afraid we would not be paying those valuations, because they wouldn't be earnings enhancing for the group. So we've had a couple of potential M&A activities that have been, we've been gazumped, and we've had the odd cul-de-sac as well. So as you know, M&A activity is binary, but I'm happy to say that the organic piece has definitely stood us in good stead, and we have a really good pipeline looking forward. Slide 21 just really reiterates what I said before about the MPS proposition and how it remains so well positioned in today's financial services arena. And, you know, obviously asset managers have had a real torrid time with redemptions. Wealth managers, you know, a little bit of growth, and platforms, a lesser amount of growth than they've had in the past. But we continue to trade very well. And that's because not only do we get brand new business from the IFAs, but we're always talking to them about converting their legacy book, which is already on platform, across to us. And we have a very, very good proposition to asset migrate assets as quickly as we possibly can. Slide 22 is a new one. And that's really been, your peers have asked us to have a look and show how we've grown in the number of firms and what kind of assets do we still maintain for those, you know, those firms that have joined us over each individual year. So you can see that we had 102 to start off with, and you can see from the light graded green that we've still got, you know, those assets have still improved, although it flattens out quite a bit, as you can see, but it moves forward. And I think for us, it shows how sticky the investments have been. And then if you go further up, you can see as we've taken more numbers on, we're actually getting a little bit more efficient in getting their assets across, or certainly the start of the assets coming across in a bigger lumpy element. So that's all good news too. Slide 23 shows you just how we started off obviously with the Paradigm firms, because they were part of the club. They were the ones who said that they needed a new investment management proposition, and we gave them what they wanted. And then, of course, the direct firms, the non-Paradigm firms, have been joining us since we floated in 2017. And that number of firms has gone up to 914 in total. So 752 are direct and 162 are Paradigm firms. So you can see how the asset over time now is favors the new firms as opposed to the old ones, which again is a signpost that we gave out a few years ago. Looking to slide 24, which is our penetration slide, this further depicts what we've just said. So on average, Paradigm firms have given us 33.6 million per firm, and the new ones that have joined us post-2017 have given us 11. So a simple bit of arithmetic, and to assume that we could get as close to the non-Paradigm firms as we have with the paradigm ones, you know, we've got a latent potential opportunity of 17 billion now. Now, I'm kind of staggered by that number, because that number gets bigger and bigger. If you go to the bottom of the table in September 18 with the number of firms that we had and where we were, we only had a potential of 5. Now we've got a potential of 17. So there's a lot of growth we can get just by working with our existing firms. But of course, we want to build that hopper up in size by bringing more and more firms into the frame. And in fact, the last stat that I saw from Brewin Dolphin before it was taken over by RBC, I think they had 1,600 firms that supported them on a weekly basis. And of course, we've got 914. So lots of potential there. On slide 25, we're just showing how we've evolved the MPS offering. So we now allow IFAs to co-brand the situation with us, so we can have a co-branded MPS, so the IFA, including Tatton. And we can also go a stage further and basically white label the portfolios and name them for that IFA. So people like Niche, Amfer, and Celtic, we have personalized and created their own portfolios. And then we can go a stage further where we actually invite one or two of the IFAs to join us on the investment committee and help make the decisions, although we have the pen and have the final decision on what's invested. So really, these opportunities, as I say, is evolving. We still get all of the 15 basis points, so we haven't given any of the 15 basis points away. So everything is there at 15. It makes it even more sticky, because obviously the IFA has got their own name above the door frame, so to speak. So we really like these. And the third advantage is we get the assets from those IFAs very, very quickly. And they're exclusive, of course. So moving on to slide 26, just to show how we've retained the asset. A key point, I think last time it was 1.2%, it's now 1.1%. So we're showing a 1.1% attrition to the consolidators who are very active in the IFA community. Some are more aggressive than others, and those aggressive ones insist that the clients are moved onto their own fund management and their own platform. We tend to find that the smaller firms are kind of attracted to that, and the bigger firms really wouldn't be. They would not want to move the asset just for the purposes of receiving more in the consideration for their practices. So consolidation is out there. There's a yin and a yang with that. I think we've said that earlier or in previous presentations. We think it's a good thing for the IFA community that consolidation seems to be working. We also think it's a good thing when IFAs are building their businesses for everyone that's for sale, another one wants to buy. And it's good to see effectively sons and daughters and family members joining existing IFA practices, because they can see they're building up value over time. Consumer duty, a big point. And we are now in receipt of a Dear CEO letter from the regulator. And to say that that letter is punchy is putting it mildly. And they've got some key focuses. And the key focuses are price and value. And effectively, you know, what are the client outcomes? I'd like to say that right from the start, we had client outcomes right at the forefront of everything that we did. And if you remember, we led with 15 basis points, which was half the going rate in the DFM MPS world at that time. So we've always put price as an important feature. And value comes from the investment performance you get from the portfolios you've chosen. And happy to say we have a long-term, very, very consistent return on assets invested through the Tatton portfolios. Our performance has been very, very consistent for an excess of a 10-year period. Lothar's got more in his pack to take you through 1, 3, and 5 year performances. So I think we tick the box for client outcomes, price and value. The other focus has been around about the interest rate clip that some platforms have been taking from interest on deposit. And of course, we don't take any of that. And we've launched our money market models, which is there as an alternative to utilizing the cash within these platforms. And again, Lothar will take you through that. So we don't benefit from that. So we can tick the box with the Dear CEO letter on that one. And then, you know, the other one that the DCO letter goes on about complexity and overtrading. I know you're overtrading because you receive revenue from that overtrading. And again, we don't receive any revenue from any rebalances or trading that we do within the portfolios. And we certainly can't be deemed a complex variant. Everything is very, very vanilla. So I think with Consumer Duty, I think we can be fairly sanguine. But I also believe that in the fullness of time, the IFAs will start to look at the assets that they've invested in other high-cost areas where the OCF is higher and maybe the performance hasn't been any better than MPS. And you could see a nice tailwind attracting BPS to MPS over the future ensuing years. So I think we then move on to our strategy. Pretty much sticking with the same strategy that we've had before. So there's nothing absolutely brand new in here. We know that the market is expected to go to 200 billion. And we've said that we want to at least maintain our market share. But if we can improve that, then we would. That means growing more firms, getting more firms working closer with them. And, you know, we also want to get as close as we can to those existing firms that we work with to get that saturation or penetration point up further. We've invested a little bit of money in some telephone account management to actually get that underway. So you can see that our partnerships are bearing fruit. The FinTeller relationship's working well, the Tenet one is, and we're obviously working with other areas as well. And we're now deploying presentation teams across the country. So last week, we were in front of 300 IFA businesses in 7 different presentations. So, you know, that's the sort of thing that we love to see managing this business. We get more and more throughput. In fact, we had a webinar this morning and we had 250 IFAs on that webinar this morning, which was nothing short of exceptional. So happy with that, happy with the growth, grow the relationships, get as close as we can, and then maybe ultimately take advantage of some M&A opportunities if they come about. But as I say, right now, we haven't got anything because of that pricing change. Turning to Paradigm and Paradigm Mortgages, Paul's taking you through the improvement in the number of firms. The protection side's gone really well for us as well. So there's been this remapping or refocusing of mortgage advisors into protection and product transfers you'd expect. And even Paradigm Consulting has grown a little bit, but also done a lot of work preparing all of the IFA firms for Consumer Duty. So I think that it's now time to pass over to Lothar.
Thank you very much, Paul. So as we've already heard, Tenet Investment Management have done pretty well. The returns to date on the investment portfolios are positive. So if you just flick the slides a little bit. Yeah, thank you. The biggest challenge, though, this year has really been on platforms, the outflows that they have seen. We haven't been that much affected by it, luckily, because of our distribution strength, but it was the attractiveness of fixed-term deposits and cash deposits that has lured some clients away with their money. And I think we've shown once again that we are responsive and innovative to market development. So one of the proposition enhancements that has gone down really well is the launch of our money market portfolios, already mentioned by Paul, which are a very straightforward, competitive model to what banks have to offer, except that we actually do offer through these the Bank of England base rate without any further risk. So these are not risk plus, cash plus, they are pure money market. And literature wise, if you look it up, that is more or less the definition of risk-free asset. And that has attracted quite some assets at this point. Around 60 million have gone in there since the summer when we launched it. We're very happy to have provided yet again, democratization tool or making something available on platform because it is possible. And the reception has been really positive. We've also taken the opportunity to offer in the upper end segment through our BPS service a gilts portfolio, which makes use of the current oddity, or not oddity, but you can buy very low coupon bonds, gilts, where the capital return is cash free, and therefore they produce a very high return after tax for advisors. And we've made that available through our slightly more bespoke portfolio service, and that's also gone down really, really well. So if we go on to the next slide, it is very visible how that risk profile, one money market portfolio, differs from the other portfolios that we have, which are obviously volatile and driven by what we have had in the markets this year. But that blue line is very, very straight. And when you think how many rate rises we've had in the interim, it just shows you how solid that portfolio performs. There is not a single kink in there. It is literally a near zero volatility portfolio proposition. So we're going to the next slide. We are now in excess of 10 years. And what I think is mostly is really positively perceived by investors and IFAs is the consistency of our returns, the alignment to the risk profile, which we can see in the risk return graph there, with the green dots being our portfolios and the black dots being the ARC peer group. The picture is not much different for the 5 years, which we've got on the next slide. So that is only sports one outlier, which is the global equity portfolio, which was launched more recently. So that doesn't quite have the 10 years yet. But because that is very much allocated along the lines of the capital markets, capitalization around the world, the market capitalization, you've got 60% there in the US, which obviously over the last decade has had exceptional performance. Whether that lasts is a different story, but that's the only reason why that is an outlier. And then last but not least, over just a year, which is on the next slide, we have also performed quite strongly and have delivered consistent returns to our advisor clients. Very happy about that. On the lower end, we've got one slight underperformance there in the defensive portfolio, which is mostly due to the fact that we're sticking very closely to the allocation of 75% to bonds in that, which obviously this year was a little bit of a tailwind. The last slide on the performance side shows the five-year returns of our ethical portfolios, which have had another strong and good year, and perhaps after the setbacks last year, have re-established the attractiveness of an ethical portfolio proposition, which we have managed for longer than most of our peers, which also explains, I suppose, if we go to the next slide, which shows the distribution of our assets under management across the different risk profiles, while they're in the right-hand column, you can see that our ethical portfolio is now taking in pretty much exactly the same as we're getting in inflow. So if that's a zero in there, or near to zero, it means it's just going very proportionally with our inflows, whereas the positive numbers tell us a relative growth, which we still have in the tracker portfolios, which in this environment are still performing quite strongly. Otherwise, the mix is not particularly changing at the moment. We're seeing a little bit of an uptick now in the higher risk portfolios, the higher equity portfolios, which is perhaps a little bit of a pity now that the bond world has had its reset and we can actually work with bond returns again. Even if we go equity underweight, we can now earn a decent enough carry through the bond holdings that we may go into. Now, just on the last three slides, a quick look into how we are seeing the markets. So first and foremost, for 2023, the big surprise was that markets, or the economy rather, has held up really well, much to the surprise of many economists who had very solidly forecast a recession to strike, which never happened. Strong job markets paired with some fiscal support in Europe and the UK because of energy, in the US because of the transition to a more sustainable energy backdrop, have meant that demand has stayed relatively strong, and thereby earnings as well. And the major headwind had been the increase in bond yields, and particularly the scare of this last tick up that we had until a couple of weeks ago, which was probably mostly to do with term premium, given inflation expectations have fallen. Therefore, that was not the reason why yields have increased further, but perhaps the risk that inflation might return over the next years has meant that bond investors now want to once again see a slightly higher term premium than may have been the case in the past. So on the next slide, where are we at the moment? Well, the picture is changing slowly. The variables are now moving towards perhaps a lesser perceived risk of a central bank policy error now that they have not only suspended further interest rate rises, but there's also first talk about perhaps this higher for longer not being quite as long, and central banks acknowledging that inflation is coming down quite rapidly. So that's been taken very positively by the markets at the moment, although we have to admit it is mostly a revaluation on the back of falling bond yields, because the outlook for earnings is still somewhat shaky, and the whole reason why investment banks can take their foot off the brakes somewhat or at least go into neutral is because the global economy is slowing, which is never a great thing for corporate earnings. So there's still a bit of a period ahead of us where we might not want to go quite equity over or risk overweight, if you like, even though we have put into portfolios selective positions and certainly locked in the higher yields that were available at the longer end of the maturity band. Our investment outlook for next year is more positive. So that's on the next slide. With volatility probably continuing, but as long as the job market remains as strong as it currently is, there is a chance that the central banks can actually succeed in manufacturing that soft landing. But there's also still a risk that the high yields eventually are leading to more defaults and therefore a credit cycle that could worsen the economic slowdown. However, in that situation, we would probably see a very rapid reduction in interest rates by the central banks, and that would be a obviously tailwind for valuations again, as long as earnings don't decline too much. But with the positive outlooks that we're already seeing and that we would broadly agree with for next year, cautiously optimistic that 2024 will offer better than the somewhat pedestrian returns that have been able to extract from capital markets during 2023.
Thank you, Lothar. So that takes us to our summary slide and questions. We'll leave that summary slide up, I think. And over to you, Hannah.
The performance AUM has been incredibly robust and much stronger than some of your competitors. Can you confirm what the competitive dynamics and risks that may be on the horizon from your competitors?
I think the only thing, obviously, you've got to keep a real watchful eye on the competition. We have lots and lots of competitors, as I said earlier. They need to have a good price. They need to also have consistent investment returns. But there are other things that you need to watch out for as well. So we, you know, our service standards, I think, are absolutely excellent. And our communications, the way we feed information into IFA practices, so when their client comes on the phone, they're fully armed with whatever we're busy with within the Tatton operation. And, you know, I think if you put the whole lot together, price, investment returns, service standards and comms, and also, you know, your distribution, we've got a fantastic distribution landscape. I think they're the sort of key elements that will keep us ahead of the curve. But, you know, we always need to keep an eye on competition like any other business.
Okay, thanks. Can you confirm capital allocation framework, dividend versus using cash for acquisitions, in terms of potential acquisition opportunities to scale up the business?
Paul, do you want to deal with that one?
Yeah, sure. I mean, we've pretty much committed to continue to pay our progressive dividend, which is broadly in line with growth in earnings. So that's 70% of of earnings. We do have headroom to utilize our cash for, in terms of headroom and our capital adequacy, to utilize our cash for small opportunistic acquisition. That said, there's nothing on the horizon at the moment. So in terms of, as we look forward sort of next 6-12 months, you know, that dividend policy will stay in place. And anything of any scale from an acquisition standpoint, we'd probably come to the market to for anyway.
Thank you. You are clearly successful at growing organically, but I wonder if you could be a little more aggressive and spend some of your profits on supercharging organic growth. So rifting on a theme here, or any more sales and marketing as another use of cash?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And it's one, again, that we mull over consistently and continually. So, you know, we think we have invested, you know, in more and more marketing. We could spend some more. It's not necessarily a proven route that it would bring more FUM in. If we thought, for example, if we doubled our business development managers, that it would double our FUM. I just don't think it's as straightforward as that, to be honest. And it's just something where we will continue to invest where we see it's necessary to, you know, to help and improve the marketing. And yeah, we've just got an element of cost that we'll build into it, but it's not going to be a big step change.
Okay. And again, on the same theme, but is M&A feasible as any target is likely to have higher fees than yours?
Oh, yeah. I mean, as we said, on average, you know, they're 22 basis points. So that's another issue if you're looking to buy businesses, because if you bought them and they're on a higher fee charge, you'd have to do some kind of reconciliation of the piece, wouldn't you? So, you know, it's another reason why it is difficult to buy. But the real big reason is just people's expectation on price.
Okay. Can you talk a little bit more, please, about succession plans in terms of next generation of leaders within the business?
That's a very good question, especially aimed at me, probably, that one. No, we've got a fantastic management team. We are always thinking of how we can expand and improve the gene pool, if you like. So we're constantly looking at that. I think basically, though, all of the key managers in the roles that we, you know, presenting here today are very, very happy. And, you know, we're not really in a position that we need to be too concerned about succession right now. But obviously, in a business the size that we are, it's something that we will be building towards and are building towards. So, yeah, probably more on that later, but no plans for anybody to step down at this stage.
Well, thank you to the three of you for your time. We look forward to receiving an update in 6 months' time on further progress.
Yeah, fantastic. Thank you, Hannah. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you. Bye.
Cheers. Bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.